All right, continuing on the 68 Pro Reverb, I've exposed a new length of the power cable, and the white and black hot and neutral will be shortened, but the full long length of this ground wire is going to a new chassis ground here. Now, this is where they had done all that yucky work attaching the standoffs for that series of resistors they put in place to derive a bias supply because they had the wrong power transformer before. So I just reused that. And while it's surrounded by ugly looking stuff, that's actually a very good solder joint right there in the middle of all that yuck. So that'll be good. And to repeat, because people ask about it in every couple videos on vendors, I restate this, so, but it's good to put it out there. The reason that you want the ground longer than the hot and neutral in a wired, hardwired connection like this is if case this were to fail and the one that was in there before had split in two and could have been pulled out by hand, that's a new one. That's a new cable clamp. But if that fails and the power cable can be pulled out of the amp, you don't want the hot to be connected and the ground to become disconnected, because then say that this pulls out and the ground were to break and this is still connected, and then the hot breaks, and when the hot breaks, if the hot lead were to touch the chassis and there's no ground, that chassis goes live. You would potentially get electrocuted. With the when this is done right and the hot and neutral are shorter than the ground, if this wire were to pull out, the first one to break would be the hot or neutral. So let's say it's the hot and it breaks out and its metal end contacts the chassis. Well, instead of the chassis going live, it'll be a dead short. You'll trip a circuit breaker, but you won't get electrocuted. So that's why we do it this way. So the hot and neutral will get shortened and the long lead of the ground will stay in place. And as long as it's not obstructing these two screw holes, which is how the chassis is held in place, it'll be fine. So it's fine for that longer length to be coiled up a little bit. It won't hurt a thing. And it won't be flopping around inside the amp in use or vibrating. Let me show you two other things we're going to do while I have the chassis iron hot before we redo the output wiring and the output tube sockets. All right, we've got two chassis solder connections. The wire here is just on top of this one, and the wire here is kind of mostly on top of this one. And over here, again, a little bit. That was not as bad as the others. I wouldn't heat up the iron just for that one. But while I have it open, I'm going to reflow this, this, and this to make sure that they're solid. So let me do that real quick, and then I'll show you the after. All right, that makes me much happier. And I know that these will be much more trustworthy. Let me show you one other thing real quick. People ask me all the time which chassis iron I use. This is what I use. And it's I've had higher wattage, like 120 watt irons in the past. And they're too hot. You can't control it. And with this one, you've got, I use this chisel tip. So I'll use just the corner if I need to, or I can use the broad blade to heat it up. What typically I'll do is I'll use the broad part of the chisel to heat up the area to begin with, get really hot, and then I'll flow solder using just the corner. So I'm able to really control the flow and get nice little domes as opposed to the spread out pools that are common. You can see the shiny area here is from the old pool of solder that was there, and there's a little dome in the middle of it. The dome is what you want. I'd rather have a small surface area with some good thickness, but still having really good cohesion, than a big pool, because once it pools out, it wants to flow out to that larger area, and it's harder to build up a thickness. So that's how I do. Okay, it's time to look at these octal sockets. I know that I'm going to redo the cathode ground connections. And I'm going to replace the screen grid resistors because they get too hot over time. Even if these have not failed yet, they will. Let's see what these measure. It's supposed to be 470 ohms. 553.7. So not too bad as far as drift. I've seen them much worse, but they will continue to rise up. Let's see what the grid stoppers measure. They're supposed to be 1.5K. They're usually like 1.8 in this spot. I don't know whether that's drifted or whether someone changed it out. I can't really see with the camera there. 2.3K. So I suspect those have just drifted. And I'm looking at them. And yeah, they're both original. So both the grid stoppers and the screen grids will get replaced. Let me take those out and show you the after the rebuild. I can't do this work with a tripod here. Sorry, just impossible. Okay, I like to get everything out, all the old solder. I disconnect the screen wires. I disconnect the grid wires. I want to get all the old solder out. And when I rebuild it, I can make sure that all the screen connection wires are on the bottom hole and the resistors are on the top hole. I can make sure everything has some good mechanical support. Now, I'm not going to put it right back together just yet. Here's what I'm going to do first. I'm going to try to make sure everything's clean. So really soak a whole bunch of isopropyl alcohol down in each one of these sockets. Just let that go down into it. We'll do the preamp ones later. And this alcohol won't hurt anything here. Might make some clean spots. On some chassis, faceplate materials, rather, faceplate and acrylics, you gotta be careful with alcohol, but because it can fatigue plastics. It won't affect this phenolic. But on the fender, it's not a concern. Just wipe off some of the excess before I flip it upside down. Not too worried about it. It'll evaporate. And flip it upside down. Then try to wick some of the solder, I mean not solder, but the alcohol and any yuck that it's carrying out of the other side. Now this may look really gross at first. Sometimes it looks really gross. This one's not so bad, but you'll get old flux and old dirt and contaminants from the decades. And everything that's between the metal of the tube socket connections and the metal of the tube pins is electronically no good. So you want to have metal to metal contact. And I've done this before where they come out looking like Keith Richards' lungs. These aren't too bad. There's a little bit of orange. That's probably just some flux. So I'm gonna let this all evaporate while I do the AC power wiring, and then once, by the time I'm done with that, all this stuff will have evaporated and I can rebuild. Certainly when you're applying alcohol in this area, initially it gets into the cloth covered wires on the heaters. You gotta wait till that fully evaporates before you can power it on again. No, not that we're ready to power this amp on right now. I would say usually in most indoor conditions, about 20, 30 minutes, that will evaporate fully. Pardon me. You can hasten that with a heat gun or hair dryer if you want. Okay, the old wiring in this app, the neutral coming here, and this wire goes to one side of the polarity switch, which had a capacitor going to chassis. More on that in a moment. And then from there, it went to the fuse holder and to a primary of the power transformer. So they had the neutral fused, And the hot went to here, went to the other side of the polarity switch with the cap, and then went to the power switch. So they were switching the hot and fusing the neutral. And that is not modern safety code. So I'm going to reuse these connections on this courtesy outlet, which will keep our connections, hot and neutral connections here very short. We're going to go hot and neutral. Actually, I'm going to check and see if there's any difference in the size of this in 68. I don't think so, but if one of them has a wider blade, that'll get the neutral. Anyway, from there, the hot is going to go all the way over to the fuse, and from the fuse to the power switch. The neutral is going to go from here to this connection on the old polarity switch, and that's where it will join the primary. So the fuse will be, the neutral will be neither switched nor fused. The hot will be fused and then switched, and that's safety code. Now, a note on the cap to ground, and in the video on that car the other day, the car Rambler, I mentioned how dumb it was to have a three-position ground switch in an amp that had a grounded power cable. And someone quite rightly pointed out that some houses still don't have grounded power, and it could be nice in that case to have an old-style polarity switch. And that can be true. It's not safe to sell electronic equipment that can possibly make up for faulty wiring. You should really have the wiring redone whenever possible. The reason I say that is you have a 50-50 chance of having it safe. And most people don't have the gear to measure to know if they have it safe or not. You know, which in theory, one way will be quieter than the other, and the safe way is quieter. And maybe enough people will get lucky, but I don't like amps that allow for the owner to rely on luck. Overriding all that, though, and why I still ding that car, is that if you're going to use a polarity switch where either the hot or neutral can have a capacitor to chassis, you cannot use an orange drop. You cannot use a blue Ajax like they did in these old Fenders. You cannot use a Sozo, you cannot use a Mallory 150. You should use a capacitor rated for a high voltage AC across it, what's called a Class X capacitor. Most of the film coupling caps we use in amplifiers are not rated for any significant AC across them. They're rated for high voltage DC, not AC. So if you must have a ground switch with a polarity cap, you should really be using an X-class film or certain ceramics, something designed for the purpose. And that car was not. That car was using a film cap just like the Fenders did. So that's not really a design consideration. That's more just copying old things that Leo did back before the U.S. safety code evolved. And electrical safety codes evolve because of incidents and accidents and hints and allegations and all that fun stuff. But anyway, you can be my bodyguard. Let me get started on all this stuff. All right, so neutral to here, that's the wide-bladed connection on the outlet. The neutral goes to here, and one of the primaries will go here, and the hot goes to here. Hot goes to this inner connector on the fuse, and then from the fuse to the power switch where the other primary will be attached. But I will attach those primaries after I finish the wiring on these octals, now that these have had a chance to evaporate, because otherwise these are just in the way of the other work. It's just, you know, there are things that are easy to do when you're building an amp, but when you're servicing an already completed amp, it's nice to, you gotta kind of plan out layers of access. And this is a good access point to finish the sockets before I put those complicating primaries in the way. A lot of times when I get these amps in, I will find that multiple wires were all in the same hole, and old wire leads were left in those holes and when old components were removed and new components are just tack soldered in place. So I take everything out and then I rebuild it in layers. So here are the screen wires. And on this one, the wire from the board comes in the bottom hole, and the wire to the next tube is also in that bottom hole, going to the bottom hole here, leaving the top hole free for the new resistor. Same thing for the grid connections, where I use the bottom hole in the socket pin for the grid wire, and that moves the new grid stopper up to the next set of holes, which is up maybe an eighth of an inch from the original. Little less prone to heat exposure there. It'll cook a little more slowly, but every little bit matters. And then when I mount the new screen grids, rather than doing it over the tube socket where that heat is, because the resistor can get hot itself, I mount them to the side, wherever there's room. And there certainly is in a fender, just to get away from the convection of the tube beneath it. So let me get those new resistors in place. You can also see I've got the ground wires connected now to the cathodes. All right. Everything in the tube sockets, the output sockets, is good. New 3-watt 470 ohm resistors. Mounted just to the side of the tube socket, and there's no way that it can contact that screw down there, so it won't be shorting. Time to reconnect the primaries, and we'll take a look at the preamp stuff. All right, I'm very pleased with that. The primaries go over here. A lot of times I snake over here. In other apps, I think it's nicer to keep them neatly dressed. You can see I still haven't put the caps nuts in, but that's all good. The next thing I want to do before I get into the preamp stuff is I want to triple check some stuff on the bias pot and then power the amp up and see what our bias pot range is and what the heaters are at, without any tubes or anything. And then we'll look at the preamp. So we're going to take this out of the cabinet for just a second, make sure that it's got a good clean connection, pot to chassis, and we're going to clean this pot, and then we'll see what the range is. Yeah, you can see a lot of yuck underneath there. Yuck is not good when it comes to grounds. Let's brush off the worst of it, get in there with some alcohol, get some of that dirt out. Let me turn the pot, let that deoxit work its way around inside. And set it to its, what should be its most negative voltage to start. Let's tighten everything back up. And that resistor value might get changed in the process of tweaking bias. I think it's a 4.7K, but I don't trust myself when it comes to resistor color bands. In a video the other day, someone said they'd never seen anyone use a socket wrench on potentiometers. How else would you do it? A regular wrench might slip and damage things. All right, let's plug this thing in. Got 117 volts coming out of the wall right now, which is a little bit low. I'm gonna turn on the light bulb limiter, just in case there's a problem in the amp. Plug it in. Sorry about hitting the tripod. All right, so let's turn on the power. All right, the front indicator bulb comes up, leaving it in standby. I'm gonna take some quick measurements. Let's see what the heaters are at. One of the reasons we changed this power transformer to the correct model for a Pro Reverb is the old one had way too much current potential. It could provide much more current than the circuit would draw, which meant that all the heater voltages were crazy high. Not getting anything at that preamp node. What am I getting here at the power tubes? If there's a clumsy edit here, I apologize. I found a potential issue once I powered it on that I realized was happening where the camera couldn't see it. So I went to measure the heater supply of the unloaded, you know, there are no output tubes in, the preamp tubes are in place, and I got 6.3 volts right now, which is great. But if I move this wire, well, it's still there now. It was coming and going, and I would get and lose the heater supply, and I suspect it's this old wire from the lamp to the octal socket. I redid the solder joints and the lamp. It could be a break in the wire, or it could just be a bad solder joint at this first octal, because I was losing it here, right? It stayed at the lamp at all times. So I'm probably gonna have to replace this wire going from the lamp to the tube socket, because that's not, you know, we just cannot have an amp that cuts out on the heater supply. And when it's at the octal, it's going all the way down to the first preamp tube. So as far as I can tell, the weakness is just in this length. That's easily remedied. But we got 6.3 something volts, which is great. It'll drop down a little bit as tubes are in place, but that's with 116 volts coming out of the wall right now. So that's artificially gonna be a little bit low. I think with this new Hammond at 120 volts and the 6V6s in place, sorry, 6L6s in place, that'll be just great. Let's check our AC at the rectifier. Should we have a little over 5 volts here? It's 5.15. Our HT center tap is 689. That's all great. Now let's make sure that we have a negative voltage at the grid of each output tube. And we'll confirm what the range is. So we've got -65.3 at both. That's great. Now, the original capacitor used in the bias circuit on our Pro Reverb was a 25 microfarad 50 volt cap. And if that cap were in place, that 50 volt cap would have 65.3 volts across it. That cap would fail. And I've seen a lot of people put in 50 volt or even 63 volt caps there because what's on the schematic. And Fender was right up against the edge with the voltages found in the 1960s with closer to 110 coming out of the wall. You cannot do that with any amp being run at modern voltages. The cap will die. So this has got a 100 volt bias cap. And the bias supply is now at its most negative, negative 65. Let's make it at its least negative, which would be the hottest setting. And it's 56 volts. And I suspect that that range is incorrect. And I need to measure what resistor is in here. All right, so that resistor in there that I said might be a 4.7K, but I also mentioned that I can't do color bands because of my color blindness, was a 68K, which would explain why we were so negative. And that was with the current limiter on. Now with the current limiter off, because I know nothing's catching on fire, checking some AC
point readings. Not getting anything at the tube sockets again. Got to change out that wire. But the supply from the transformer unloaded is 6.49 now, which is great. That'll come right down. When the tubes are in place, let's go back to bias world. So before, with the 68K resistor, we had a range of negative 65 to negative 55. Of course, that was with the current limiter on. With the current limiter off, and the 27K from the schematic temped in place, because I'm not sure if that's going to be the final one, from negative 63 to negative 44. That still, I think, is going to be on the cold side. But I will wait till we have tubes in place. I imagine that'll go down to 18K, 22K, rather than the 27K. But once the tubes are in place, I know what the current draw is. I'll worry about that. So the first thing I've got to do before we can get to the preamp is I've got to probably replace this length of wire, because we keep losing the voltage at the tube sockets. All right, the heaters are all secure now. It was the classic issue of tube wires being inside the solder joint and the solder actually adhering to one of the two wires. The second wire was trapped inside the solder joint by the first wire, but it had never been soldered, and over the years, corrosion had crept into the little spaces and gaps, and the center lead of that wire was just dirty, just corroded. So took them all out, get all the old solder out, tinned them, put them back, ensured good solder connections. Also flipped the wiring on this one so that the 7-to-7 and 2-to-2 on the output tubes. And that's good. So I will be triple checking the heater voltage for all the other stuff just in case similar issues crop up somewhere else in the heaters. But now I know that the octals are staying lit at all times. I know that the bias range is safe. May need to be improved a little bit, but it's safe. I know that the AC wiring is safe into code. I got to trim off a little excess there. I know the output, the power transformer is in place. Well, the bias is good. Filter caps are good. Time to dig into the nonsense that is this preamp. All right, time for the preamp stuff. So let's just go through this. Got replaced bias grid leaks here. Originally, there would have been a standoff here, probably that 68K, you know, split bias arrangement, but that's gone. It's got some carbon films for the plates. Let's take a quick measurement on all four of those and make sure that the correct values are in. And this amp is getting enough work done overall that I'm not sure how much will be left for making it, you know, perfect versus working well. Those are all the correct values. All right, let's see here. We got a replaced cap. The input is film rather than the original ceramic. That makes a slight difference in the sound. Again, that may come down to budget. It's got the original cathode bypass cap here. That needs to be changed out. It's got a changed out roach, not very beautifully changed out, with some ugly looking solder joints. I'll retouch that. They've got a 10 nanofarad in parallel with this 10 nanofarad, and a 22 here to slow the trim down a little bit. If that's working fine, that's working fine. Okay, that's just a spiral wrap that they did at this era for shielding, partial shield. Original cathode bypass caps here, that's going to get replaced. Shittily replaced cathode bypass caps here and here, way up in the air. A tack soldered resistor. Let's just start from the input and measure all the cathode resistors. Those can drift with bad effects sometimes. 1.8, 2.18, that one's
This one's a tiny bit high, that's a normal range. This one's exceeding the desired tolerance range. Here should be 820. .985, that's not too bad. This should be a 2.2. It's a 3.7, and it's spliced. This one's getting replaced. And we should have another 820. Measures just over 1K. And then this 2.7 measures 3K. That's actually within tolerance, but it's not the best. Let's just measure some other crucial resistors while we're in here. We've got 100, 120, 100, 107, 100, 130. That one's out of spec. 100, 111, 100, 107, 100, 127, again out of spec. You got a replaced film cap there, used to be ceramic. That one makes a difference. It's got this shielded wire added, not beautifully done. And not too trustworthy. A little excess length, I'll redo those. See this 1 meg. This is a spot where there's often DC buildup on the board. I'll be checking that very carefully. It's supposed to be 100K, 114, 100K, 114, 3 meg, 3.3 meg rather, measures 3.5. This 470 is going to give an inaccurate reading because of it's in parallel, 165. 165, 220, okay. 220, not getting a measurement. 263, that's a bit out of spec. 100K, 117, 10 meg, 11.78 meg. These 220 Ks here. 258, 266, right on the verge of being out of spec. This 100 ohm measures 108. A few videos ago, I measured a similar 100 ohm resistor. In circuit, it measured about 80 something ohms, and I said it was under spec, and someone quite rightly pointed out that, well, that's in parallel with the negative feedback to the output tap, and so that will artificially measure low. And while that's true to an extent, you get an idea of what the range you measure in circuit is. So out of circuit, this measures 108.3. We're going to remeasure this in a little bit, and across this negative feedback resistor, we get 108.4. Let's disconnect the negative feedback real quick, because we're going to be doing some solder work in this area anyway, and see where things are at with that. If it measures 108 ohm in circuit, what does it measure out of circuit? Get my pliers. Out of circuit, that measures 122. So that is out of spec by quite a bit. And there's some really ugly solder joints here and here. And then the rest of the stuff in the phase inverter, this 470 measures 0.74, so 740, that's twice as high as it should be. This 22K measures 30.7, that's out of spec as well out of spec. So I know the things that need to be changed are certain resistors, and all the cathode bypass caps. These were done previously poorly. These were never done. All this stuff matters. And this 100K here, can't measure that 100K with a cap across it. Let's lift that cap out. In fact, let's lift all the original bypass caps out while we're in this area. For science, we'll take a measurement on them, see what they actually read now. Let's see what we actually get on those. So this one is supposed to be 25. We'll be replacing it with a 4.7, though. Actually measures 37 microfarad. That's a little bit out of tolerance. And these 60 microfarad, about 60 microfarad. And this one, 48. So these two are way over spec. This one's a little bit over spec, but they're old and unreliable at this point anyway. And this 100K measures 115K. That's actually within spec. Just barely. So I know what to do. I'm gonna get these old cathode bypass caps out and some of the resistors that I know I'll be changing, and we'll take up from there. All right, it's powered up. It's the first time it's been powered up here. I had to change out the rectifier tube. The rectifier it came with was bad. It's got a JJ in there now. All the other tubes are the ones provided. And I've got it biased, idling about 44%, and that trim pot is almost maxed out. So that 27K needs to be reduced to get a better range. That's as I expected. That's why I left those leads really long. There's a little bit of a rushing water noise, and that may be the phase inverter tube. That may be something earlier in the preamp, and maybe the power tubes. So I'm going to, it doesn't have V1 in it right now. I'm going to pull V4. And if all that noise goes away, then I know where to look. It'll be in the preamp. If that noise stays there, I'll try a different phase inverter tube. And, yeah. Sorry. It goes away. Oh, what a shock. Electroharmonics. Those are almost always bad these days. I don't know why. They're made in the same factory as Tungsols and Softex and other things. It's got an old RCA 7025 that was in V2. And this is potentially an expensive tube. It's probably original to the app, but we're going to put this in V5 and see if noise comes back. Because the old tubes can be very noisy. When they're not noisy, they can sound fantastic. No argument for me. Little bit of rushing water, not much. That may just need to have the tube sockets cleaned. Remember, I did the power sockets. I've not done the preamp sockets. So instead of that EH, I'm going to stick this Mesa SDR in V2. Rushing. All right, that's worse than the EH. Let's try something else. Here's a like a 70s or 80s 12AX7. Let's see how it sounds. A little bit of rushing water as it heats up, then it dissipates. That seems to be related to me moving this wire. That may just be some funk in that socket. I will take a look at that. V1's out, so that channel's out for right now.
see what the noise is like on the volume for the vibrato channel. Not too bad. Not too much noise when I move that. I'm gonna give that pot a squirt real fast and see if it cleans up. We'll do some DC measurements on the board. That may have sounded like a lot, but I've got the nozzle set to dispense a small amount at a time. That's better. Well, that seems pretty good for initial behavior. All right, let's take some DC measurements. About 200 millivolts here. And you clean that part of the board. You see where here is? You got about 200 millivolts on this. That needs to go away. Even without a tube in V1, we should get some DC on those if it's a problem. We're good on those. Let's check here. About almost 200 millivolts here. That's a spot I usually have to clean. That'll show up there as well. No DC here. I mean, it makes an awful noise. That's actually normal. And here, nothing on the vibrato channel. That expected leakage from here on the trim channel, which means that this one here is going to be good. So as far as leakage on the board goes, this amp's really good about it. Nothing major. I can clean that up just by pulling it and heating it all up, probably. And the same for here. But none of that's enough to affect the general sound. And I'm sure that this needs some other preamp tubes here and there. Nothing's too microphonic. And that sounds like I just need to clean the preamp sockets. Let's get a sense of what it sounds like first. A little bit of noise there. Cap doesn't seem to be doing much. Check the connections on that. Maybe that switch isn't making contact when it closes. Sometimes they fail. They do get a lot of strain on relatively flimsy bits of metal on these things. All right, so it's intermittent now. Let me take a look at the little metal prongs that hold those tabs in place. May have to do some more of that with the amp off so I can get better access without electrocuting myself. Let's give that just a squirt inside there. Make sure it doesn't just have corrosion on its contacts. Now that switch is physically a little bit flimsy. It's just got these metal prongs that kind of make a little J hook around part of the phenolic, and it can get loose. I'll tighten that up, but I can't do that one-handed right now. That sounds pretty damn good. Let's hook up a reverb tank and check the vibrato. The reverb's working. It doesn't mean the tank that came with the amp is working, but this one, it's working, the circuit. And the vibrato, let's see. I've got little dummy RCA plugs, but they're in one of the other fenders that are here, and I don't want to track it down right now. I'll just use a screwdriver to give myself a temporary. Well, it's nice and deep and it's not ticking. It's definitely very slow because of the changes. In fact, I think it's slower than the changes indicate. I suspect one or both of those ceramic disc caps have drifted in value a little bit, but that's not important right now. Put that EH that I suspected of being noisy when it was in V5 into V1. Even if the owner doesn't use a tube in the first channel and never uses it, I need to make sure that's working. And that jack is not giving me any good physical resistance. There's no click to it. Where did that one? That's odd. Nothing is physically in the way. I think they're just worn out. That one's got a nice solid feel to it. That's pretty wimpy. Let's see what it sounds like. That switch is good. And I'm not getting all the noises that I was getting with that tube at the beginning. Maybe something just needed to warm up. I definitely need to clean the preamp slot, tube sockets. So, next things I need to do, I'm gonna clean the preamp tube sockets. I'm gonna try to retension the bright switch on the vibrato channel. I'm going to take out, clean, and put back in these jacks and see if it's a metal fatigue thing or if they're just not sitting right. If the owner doesn't use it and he wants to leave the old original jacks, even if they're not the best, that's fine. I mean, it's working, obviously. But it pulls out way too easily. There's no retention to that. Take a look at that again. I am going to clean up the shielded wiring, because it's extra, extra long, and that's not extra, extra good.
So cleaning, fixing that switch, hopefully, a little tweaking here and there, and we'll see where we're at that point. And I'll talk to the owner about whether he wants the trim kept this kind of exaggeratedly slow or whether he wants it stock. And I also need to change out that temporary resistor in the bias supply to get a better range overall. But this is a good place to stop. The amp is sounding pretty damn great, even if it can get even better. I guess I should point out real quick again all the things that I did change here. So the 1 megs are remaining the same in the phase inverter. The 470, the 22K, the 820, and the 100 ohm have all been changed out. The 100 ohm has got those little curves in case the board continues to expand. I cleaned up the entire board with some alcohol. I changed out this, all 7 of the cathode bypass caps. This one got a 4.7. I made sure the ground wires coming from the rest of the board were crimped over the edge of the eyelets. New 220K here in the vibrato channel because the old one was way out of spec. A new 2.2K cathode resistor for the tremolo driver. The reverb driver. New 1.5K here. This one had drifted too high. This one still has 1.8 for this channel. Cleaned everything up. I need to go through here and get a little bit of DC off of this point and this point. But overall, we're in a great place. So this is where this video will stop.